Okay, next we have Sam Childers, who's going to talk about the Johnson Rooming House here in Oakland.
I'm going to talk about the Johnson Rooming House at 1026 North Beckley. This is the home that Lee Harvey Oswald was living in at the time of the assassination. The house was built in 1923, and the area is called the, as most of you know, the Lake Cliff District. It's the area started to develop after Charles Mangold built a park there in 1906. In 1914, the city of Dallas purchased a portion of the park to use as a city park for $55,000. In 1919, city planner George Kessler created a master plan for the area that added athletic fields, a new swimming pool, and a formal rose garden. As I said, the improvement of the area led to development of the neighborhood nearby and construction of homes in the area during the late teens and early 20s really blossomed. They were primarily bungalows built, four squares, and small apartment buildings. They were, majority were Tudor Revival, Prairie School, or Craftsman style homes. And as the neighborhood developed, small commercial buildings were constructed, particularly along Colorado and Zang Boulevards. The first tenant and the builder of 1026 North Beckley was William C. Barnes. He was an Oak Cliff businessman and civic leader, and he, as I said, he built the house in 1923. He owned the Groves Barnes Lumber Company. He served as president of the Oak Cliff Dallas Commercial Association, was a board member of the Jefferson Bank and Trust, the Continental Southland Savings and Loan Association, and the Metropolitan Building and Loan Association. He was also founder of the Own Your Own Home campaign of 1922-23, which is appropriate since he built the home that year. In addition, he was a charter member of the Dallas City Plan Commission, which was established by Dallas Mayor Joe Lawther in 1919. He and his wife Clara and their three sons resided at 1026 North Beckley until 1929. Over the next decade, what we could glean from our research was that the house was probably rented to a number of different tenants over the next 10 years. Perhaps one of the most interesting and prominent was the home was occupied by Dr. Jason Cox and his wife, who lived there from 1934 to 1936. Dr. Cox was a naturopath, a homeopathic doctor, and he operated his practice out of the home. And according to the current owner, Pat Hall, who I'm going to recognize here in just a moment, Dr. Cox used the five basement rooms as offices and rooms in a separate outbuilding as a sort of a hospital, patient rooms. After they moved out in 1936, it was rented for the next 4 years to a number of tenants. And then in 1940, Amy Gladys Arant purchased the home. And she was a widow originally from Alto, Texas. She was a hardworking entrepreneur. She owned and managed Arant's Cafe at 1029 Young Street in downtown Dallas. And she also earned additional income by converting some of the rooms in the house and the entire basement and the detached outbuilding to boarders who rented rooms and lived there. They were primarily single men. And 1947, she married Arthur Johnson. He was a Kentucky native who moved to Dallas with his parents as a child. Mr. Johnson was a carpenter, but after his marriage to Mrs. Johnson, he assisted her in managing the restaurant, which was renamed Johnson's Cafe. In October of 1963, Mrs. Johnson was home after working at the restaurant when a young man named Lee Harvey Oswald appeared at the door inquiring about a room after seeing a for rent sign posted in the yard. Mrs. Johnson told him that she had just rented the last room, but to check again if the sign was up later. On October 14th, 1963, he returned after Mrs. Johnson had again posted the sign in the yard. She agreed to rent the small room in the inside of the home, in the main residential part of the home, for $8 a week. He registered with the name O.H. Lee. Mrs. Johnson allowed Oswald television privileges and, in an unusual move, allowed him to use the refrigerator, which is something she didn't do for most of the tenants. Oswald typically lived at the Johnson Rooming House during the week and at the Payne home in Irving, where his wife Marina lived on the weekends. According to Mrs. Johnson, he was quiet, clean, and well-mannered, and he ate his dinners of primarily sandwiches out of his room and rarely spoke to others in the house. You can see here the images of the period 1963 and then a picture taken there in 2003. Oswald uncharacteristically spent the evening of November 21st, 1963 at the Payne home in Irving and rode to his job at the Texas School Book Depository in downtown Dallas the next morning with a co-worker. Oswald carried a long wrapped package that he told his co-worker contained curtain rods to work that morning. It was later determined that the package contained Oswald's rifle. President Kennedy was struck by assassin's bullets in Dealey Plaza at 12:30 on November 22nd, as you all know. At about 1 p.m., Oswald arrived at the Johnson Rooming House, and the housekeeper, Ms. Arlene Roberts, was surprised to see him in the middle of the day and remarked to him that he seemed to be in quite a hurry. He made no reply. A few minutes later, Oswald emerged from the room, zipping up his jacket, and rushed out of the house. Approximately 14 minutes later, a man that fit Oswald's description shot and killed Patrolman J.D. Tippett near the intersection of 10th and Patton in Dallas. I want to show you just a diagram of the interior of the home here. The small room, number five there, was the small room that Oswald occupied. It's barely two large steps across to get from the doorway to the wall. It contained a bed and a small nightstand and a little dresser was the only furnishings in the room when Oswald occupied it. The number one there is the porch. Number two is quite a large living room, and four there is the dining room. There are a couple bedrooms off there, number three and number 11, off to the right-hand side. And then at the back is the kitchen and a what we believe was a converted sleeping porch that was later used converted into a full bedroom. As I said, Oswald rented the room at the same time he was hired at the Texas School Book Depository, stayed there during the week, and unexpectedly spent the night in Irving getting a ride with P.L. Frazier that morning of the assassination. This is the corner of Neely Street. When Oswald left the book depository, he first got on a bus, which was stuck in traffic. He exited the bus and took a taxi. He had the taxi drop him off a few blocks down from 1026 North Beckley at this intersection on Neely. Incidentally, at one time, Oswald lived for a brief time on Neely Street. And then after the assassination, the rooming house and its occupants were interviewed by the Warren Commission. If you can see here, this is Pat's grandmother here. And then this is Arlene and Gladys, the housekeeper and the owner of the home. I introduced Pat. She's the current owner of the house, and in June of this year, she placed the home up for sale. And I have to say that one of the most enjoyable afternoons I've had this whole year was spent with Pat, looking at old photographs and reminiscing about her mother and her grandmother and the historic significance of the home. So, Pat, thank you very much. Now we're ready for Ferris Rick Stuhl talking about the Tippett shooting.